The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Call our story The Presence. Now, presence is variously defined as an apparition or specter, and as a person or being, especially an invisible one, conceived of as present, but not necessarily there. It's an indefinite sort of word, presence, and the definitions are not very helpful. Yet I think each one of us intuitively knows what a presence is.
What happened, for heaven's sake?
I don't know.
You knew all the answers.
I thought I did.
You did. I went over them with you the night before. Now tell me, young man, what happened?
I went into the room. They handed out the test papers. I looked at the questions. I knew them all. I opened up my composition book.
Yes, yes.
All of a sudden, I didn't know anything at all. Nothing. So I left.
Our mystery drama, The Presence, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Elspeth Eric and stars Norman Rose. I'll be back shortly with Act One. With a start from a sound sleep. Sitting placidly before an open fire, have you ever felt a sudden chill? Immersed in a book, have you unexpectedly looked up from its pages? Walking down a street, have you, for no sensible reason, turned your head to look behind you? If you have, chances are it was because you felt, you sensed a presence, and there was no one there but you.
Why had I bothered to make all my money? Just to own this big house? A stable of prized thoroughbreds? To become master of the Eastover hunt? Was that all it had bought me? A wife who tippled all day long and half the night? And a son who had failed at the university?
Stop pacing about. Oh, you're making me nervous.
You're always nervous.
Well, that's true enough.
To hear from Gordon?
Just the one card from Newfoundland.
You never showed me that.
Well, I mislaid it.
I don't suppose he said anything much. Having wonderful time. Wish you were here.
Just love, Gordon.
Nothing about the ship? His stateroom? I got him the best, you know, forward on A-deck. Well, nothing about the food, the passengers, just love, Gordon.
Well, that's enough. For me, anyway.
I think the whole idea was ridiculous.
Well, it's what the neurologist recommended. He's supposed to know.
They don't know anything, those doctors. Not a blessed thing. All they want is your money.
Now, Owen.
Take a long sea voyage. See the world. Change of scene. New places, new people. Very easy for them to say. Suppose I hadn't been able to pay for it. What then?
But you were able to.
But if I hadn't been, he'd have had to go to work, wouldn't he?
Gordon was in no fit state to go to work.
He'd have had to. That's what I did when I was his age. Went to work, started at the bottom and worked my way up.
I know. You told me. I know it by heart.
Well, I think I'll have a whiskey soda. You care to join me?
No, thank you.
When do you do your drinking, Nellie? I'd really like to know.
You have never, ever seen me drunk, Owen.
True. Nor have I ever seen you sober. You must start early in the morning before I wake up.
It's necessary for my back pains. You know that.
I don't know if you even have any back pains.
Ever since Gordon was born, I've had this bad back. I don't know why you begrudge me a little relief from pain. Don't I run this house for you, get your meals on the table, entertain your guests, do everything a wife is supposed to do? I don't know what more you could ask.
I don't know either. It's just that... Well, there ought to be something more.
If you're going to keep after me and keep after me about this, that, and the other...
I am not going to keep after you about anything. I simply want to talk to you about Gordon.
What's to talk about? Gordon will be fine. He just has to find himself.
Yes. It all started when he flunked that exam. That's when he changed.
Nerves, that's all it was.
But why then? June the 15th it was. A comprehensive exam.
A nervous collapse. All the doctors said so.
But why then? Why June 15th? He passed all the other exams. Always been a good student, got high grades and everything.
Overworked, they said. Strained.
And I'd gone over everything with him. He knew all the answers.
Strained his mind.
He went in there prepared. I know that for a fact. And what happened? He turns in a blank paper, writes his name at the top, and that's all. Writes his name at the top. Hands it in and walks out. Didn't even try. That's the worst part. How's he ever going to amount to anything if he doesn't try?
Oh, and I'm going upstairs.
I asked him about it, you know.
Yes, I'm sure you did.
I had to know what happened. He said he went into the room, they handed out the questions. He knew all the answers, opened up his composition book, wrote his name at the top of the first page, and then, all of a sudden, he didn't know the answer to anything.
He was nervous. You don't know what it is to be nervous. You never have. But I do. I know what it's like, and it can be terrible things to you, things you know nothing about.
I hope I never do. Did I hear the door open?
I didn't hear anything.
The front door. Did you hear it?
Who would just walk in like that?
Well, who has a key?
Well, no one but Austin.
Hello?
Gordon!
Where on earth did you come from?
Why didn't you let us know?
Well, not that we're not glad to see you.
I thought you were on the ocean.
I was.
Well, what happened? Did you like it?
I liked the water. I kept hoping I'd see a whale or some dolphins, but I never did. I guess they live out further where it's deeper. I don't know. Anyway, no whales, no dolphins, so I took the next boat back from Newfoundland. And here I am.
Why didn't you let us know?
I didn't think of it.
We'd have met you.
I took the hackney coach from the station. Had a little trouble with the front door.
Did you have a key?
Wouldn't turn in the lock for some reason. But somebody opened it for me. When did you hire a butler?
A butler? We'd never had a butler.
Butlers are hard to come by these days.
It's funny, I could have sworn it was a butler who opened the door for me. I didn't speak to him or anything. He didn't speak to me.
It must have been one of the maids.
I suppose it could have been. Right now, I'd like to go up to my room and change. I've been in these clothes for a long time.
Oh, where's your valise?
You want me to get it for you?
Oh, never mind. I'll see to it.
All right. You go on upstairs and change, and then come back down, and we'll have a drink together.
All right. That'll be, very nice. I won't be long.
Huh. Well, what do you make of that?
He's not himself. He's just not himself.
It's worse than when he went away. Now he's seeing things.
He should never have gone away. He should have stayed here where people love him. I could have taken care of him. He shouldn't have gone off all alone to be with strangers. Maybe if I'd gone with him.
Grown men don't take their mothers along on a trip like that.
Well, somebody should have been with him.
Meaning me?
Meaning somebody. Oh, I don't know. I just know he should never have gone. He should have stayed home.
Well, now that he's here, maybe things will get better. When he starts to settle in, look up his old friends, decide what he wants to do with his life.
I think he's coming downstairs.
Gordon?
We're waiting for you, dear.
How do I look?
Oh, splendid, splendid. Now, how about a drink?
I didn't take a bath. I hope I'm presentable.
You look fine. Have I told you how glad I am to have you home? Come sit down.
Yes. I'll make you a drink. And another for myself.
Hold up on that, will you? I'd like to get something to eat first.
Let me fix you something.
I'd like to do it myself.
All right, whatever you say.
Well, do whatever you like. Anything at all.
Thank you. Can I fix anything for either of you?
Oh, not for me.
Oh, I don't care for anything, thank you.
Oh, by the way, thank you, Mother, for laying my clothes out for me.
But I didn't.
They look nice. All spread out on the bed, waiting for me to put them on.
Gordon, your mother and I have not stirred from this room.
Well, that's right. So you haven't. Well, it must have been the butler, then.
Well, there is no butler.
Or maid, or whoever did it. Thank him for me, or her. I'll come back as soon as I fix myself a bite to eat.
Oh, and I'm frightened.
Yes, so am I.
Still, he doesn't seem unhappy. I mean, that's something.
Lunatics don't seem unhappy either.
Don't you dare call my son a lunatic. He's a neurasthenic. That's what the doctor said, a neurasthenic.
Nellie, he walks in here, thinks a butler opens the door for him. He goes upstairs and thinks somebody's laid out his clothes for him.
Well, now, listen, I might have done that. I've spent a lot of time in his room since he's been away. I might have gone over his things and, maybe I left some of them out on the bed, meaning to have them pressed or something.
Why would you do that? Well, we didn't expect him back for 3 months.
I didn't say I did it. I said I might have.
Yes, I suppose you could have done anything under the influence.
Now, don't start that again. I don't do strange things. I just take a little whiskey for the pain.
A lot of whiskey.
Well, sometimes I have a lot of pain. Now, let's not discuss it.
We'd better discuss what we're going to do with Gordon.
We're not going to do anything with Gordon. We're going to welcome him home and make him comfortable and feeling loved and cherished and looked after. And any little strangeness, well, we are simply going to overlook it. Pretend you don't notice, and after a while, you'll see. He'll be all right.
You think so, do you?
I'm positive. Love conquers all. That's what they say, and I believe it with all my heart.
I hope you're right.
Hey, look what I found in the kitchen.
Something good?
Mm, cold sliced chicken and some salad all set out on the table. Like it knew what I wanted and had it ready for me. Anybody want some of it? There's plenty. Mother? Father?
Nellie shook her head no, and I muttered something about waiting for dinner. Gordon sat there looking pleased and contented and finished the whole plate. He didn't seem to question the fact that food had been left for him in the kitchen when there hadn't been anyone in the kitchen to leave it for him. Near the turn of our century, a widely recommended treatment for what was then called neurasthenia was a long sea voyage. It was known as the Weir Mitchell Cure. The throb of the ocean, the sea air, and the isolation of the patient from life's hurly-burly were supposed to bring him back to normal. It was eventually abandoned because isolating people from life's hurly-burly also isolated them from human help. The mighty ocean could not, of itself, effect a cure. I'll be back shortly with Act Two. May on occasion feel the presence of Rembrandt, a poet that of Keats or Shelley, a playwright that of Shakespeare. An inventor may sense the presence of Edison, a scientist that of Einstein. And of course, the religious strive constantly to feel the presence of God.
My husband and I sat awkward and nearly silent. While Gordon finished his plate of cold chicken and salad. I couldn't tell what Owen was thinking, but my mind was crammed with the wildest of conjectures. Gordon looked peaceful and was happy. Was this a sign that he had recovered, or did it mean that he had lost leave of his senses entirely? I returned his plate to the last scrap, excused himself. Going to his room for a nap.
What do you think?
I don't know what to think.
And neither do I.
I think he's all right.
Well, he looks all right.
Well, that's what I mean. He looks fine.
Good appetite.
And his color's good.
Doesn't seem a bit nervous. You know, it's possible the sea voyage did him good. That is possible, isn't it? Even if he did cut it short.
Maybe he just needed to get away for a bit.
Now, listen. I have an idea. There's a meet tomorrow. Why don't we all ride out?
Oh, Owen, I don't really like fox hunting. You know that. I'm always so afraid there'll be a kill.
Oh, don't be silly. Generally, we draw a blank. You know that. Anyway, tomorrow will be just cubbing, training the young hound. What do you say? Gordon's got a good seat. He knows the countryside.
He's never hunted.
Well, he can stay back in the field. I'll have to be up front because I'm the master, but well, he'll stay behind with you.
Maybe I'll just go hilltopping up on Moon Ridge. You can see everything from there.
Well, if you want to. Well, come on, let's go tell him.
Owen, let me talk to him first. I don't want you bullying him into going, making him feel ashamed if he doesn't feel like
it. I wouldn't do that.
Well, you've been known to.
I just thought a day of good hunting, watching the hounds work, you know, feeling a horse under him.
You won't over mountain now.
I'll put him on Princess. That old mare knows the ground better than I do. She could cover it by herself. She's got every jump memorized. She's taken them so many times. Yeah, she's a wise old lady. I'd put a 4-year-old child on her back.
Well, I'll go after. Give me a few minutes, then you come up. I told myself that a day's hunting might be just the thing. Short trip to Newfoundland and back. I certainly haven't hurt him, and in some ways it seems to have done him good. But I wouldn't force him. I was determined about that. And I wouldn't let Owen force him either.
Yes?
It's Mother, darling. All right to come in?
Come in.
You were asleep, were you?
No, I was just lying here thinking.
Pleasant thoughts, I hope?
Well, not really thoughts. More like wondering.
Wondering? I don't know that I've ever heard of wondering.
Maybe I made it up.
And what were you wondering?
I'm wondering why things happen the way they do instead of some other way. Why did I fail that exam in June? Why did I let you send me on that sea trip? Why did I decide to come back when I did?
Well, why did you?
I don't know. Something told me to. Or somebody.
You were with somebody?
Oh. I was all by myself.
Gordon, I have the postal card you sent me from Newfoundland. I'd like you to look at it.
What for?
I haven't sent it to your father. He didn't ask to see it, as a matter of fact. I told him it just said love, Gordon.
I couldn't think of anything else to say.
Well, it says love, but it doesn't say Gordon.
Of course it does.
Look at it.
Love? What's this?
Initial.
H-G-M. Hold on.
That's why I thought perhaps you were with somebody when you wrote it.
No, I was alone. H-G-M? I don't know anybody with those initials.
Well, never mind. Doesn't matter.
H-G-M. I don't know any H-G-M. Never have.
Then give it back to me.
Am I losing my mind, Mother?
No, of course you're not losing your mind. You're fine. You're perfectly fine. Now, listen. Your father has had a simply marvelous idea.
Oh, he has. Another sea voyage?
No, no, nothing like that. You're home, and you're going to stay home. No, it's something quite different. Tomorrow there's a meet. It's not a formal hunt. They don't start from the fall. It's just cubbing. You'll love watching the hounds working and being exercised. I'm going hilltopping where I can watch the whole thing. Well, how do you feel about it?
Have I got the proper things to wear? The hunting people are so fussy.
Do you really want to go?
I've still got that old tweed rat catcher, haven't I?
Of course, and you can wear your father's derby. Because he'll be wearing a hunt hat. Oh, Gordon, I'm so pleased you want to go.
It'll be fun.
Why did I come in?
Owen, Gordon says he'll be delighted to join the hunt.
Good, good.
If you'll lend me a derby.
Of course I will. Now, there are a few things I have to tell you. First of all, stay well back in the field because you're a new member.
I understand.
Don't go taking every jump in sight. You're out there to watch the hounds work.
Yes, sir.
Don't crowd coming down to the fences. Wait your turn.
Yes, sir.
Keep a horse's length at all times between you and the horse in front of you, so if the rider goes down, your horse won't step on him.
Yes, sir.
Keep your eyes up. Look where you're going.
Mm-hmm, yes, sir.
Keep up. Don't drop back, or you'll lose the field and make everyone behind you lose it, too.
Yes, I understand.
Yes, and one last thing. Then I'm through. If you can't control your horse, go home.
Yes, sir.
And whatever you do...
Owen, that's enough, really.
Whatever you do, whatever happens, don't tread on a hound. Understand? No matter what, never tread on a hound.
No, sir, I won't.
All right, then. See you in the morning at the meet.
Oh, Gordon, I'm so happy you go along with your father's idea.
I think it's a very good idea.
He's never really hunted, you know.
Oh, I'll be all right.
It's very exciting. There'll be a lot of people.
I have a feeling that I'll like it.
You've just come home. Maybe we should wait.
No, I think I should go tomorrow. In fact, I'm sure.
What makes you sure?
Well, I don't know exactly, but something does. Or somebody.
He looks so calm, so serene, so sure of himself. Like a confident, self-assured little boy. Like a little boy who'd once been. I couldn't bring myself to pursue the argument any further, so I kissed him gently on the forehead and went out. From the top of Moon Ridge, I could watch the whole and sober hunt gallery. Hear the hounds speaking in their many voices. What hunting folk call making music. A husband's master wore his tanks in a hunt cap. The civicets, the hunt servants, and the hunt staff. Others dressed decorously in black coats, derbies, white socks, and bright yellow vests. Then I heard the huntsman's horn. And his call to the hunters.
Comprehensive exam. Aha, what have we here?
I certainly wasn't living up to what he ought to be.
Well, he didn't. I never
said... He didn't live up to what you thought he ought to be. What about what he wanted to be? What about that?
Ever since he failed that exam.
He's insane. All right, I grant you that. And now he's falling off a horse. Well, who cares if he fails an exam or falls off a horse?
I do. I care. He makes me sorry I ever had a son.
Well, stop being sorry, my dear, because you never did. You never did. Are these words really coming out of my mouth? I couldn't stop them because they felt so good. So good. As though an abscess had been punctured and an infection drained out. I had never in my life felt so exuberant, so strong, so well.
Has all this to do, you may be asking, with a present? So far, I have given you only a simple story of a simple family with simple family problems. But we know, do we not, that no family is simple, nor is its story, nor are its problems. As for the present, you will have to wait for Act 3 to discover its significance. On impulse, not once, but many times. If you tell me you have always carefully considered every move you've made, I shall not believe you. You've turned a corner, or you've spoken to a stranger, or you've quit a job or taken one, because at a certain moment, something told you to. And of course, the greatest impulsive moments of your life have been those when you fell in love.
Drawn, trying to find out why, since my mind went blank at 10 o'clock in the morning on June the 15th, I'd done one thing after another without reason. I'd done what I was told to do, embarked on a sea voyage, then reversed myself and came home. Cheerfully agreed to join a hunt. Then, over the first little jump, surrendered the reins, let my feet out of the stirrup. Made no effort at all to get back on my horse. Simply took hold of her reins and led her back to the stable. Why was I doing these contradictory things? Voices floated up to me from downstairs. My mother's voice.
He's been strange. All right, I grant you that. And now he's fallen off a horse. Well, who cares if he fails an exam or falls off a horse? Who cares?
My sweet, patient mother talking like a shrew? And my father?
I care. He makes me sorry I ever had a son.
Well, stop being sorry, my dear, because you never did. You never did.
What on earth could they be talking about? Why were they both so angry? Were they angry with me? Or with each other? Or had I made them so angry with me that they became angry with each other? Somewhere, somehow, I'd made some dreadful mistake that had destroyed the serenity of this house. I crept halfway downstairs and listened.
What did you say? What did you say just now?
I said you never had a son. He was never yours, never.
Gordon?
Yes, Gordon. He's not yours. You're not his father. He's not your son. Bartle, I wanted to tell you that. Now I have.
You don't mean what you're saying. You're just saying it because you want to get back at me for something.
I'm saying it because it's the truth. Gordon is not your son.
Nellie, don't you lie to me.
I wouldn't lie about a thing like that. Why would I lie? It's the truth. It's the solemn truth.
Nellie, I swear I swear.
Oh,
look.
I didn't mean... Gordon! Come down here, Gordon! I mean...
Mother, I'm right here.
Gordon, I've done a terrible thing. Your father, he seems to have a stroke or something, a heart attack.
Wait.
Is he dead? Oh, God, tell me he isn't dead.
I don't think so.
How could I have been?
Mother, you'd better call a doctor.
Yes, I will. I'll call the doctor first. You stay with him. I'll call the doctor.
Father, can you hear me? Can you feel that? Father. Now, listen. You're going to be all right. Mother and I are here, and we're going to take care of you. We'll be right here. Mother's calling the doctor right now. And he'll come over, and he'll fix everything. And you'll be all right. I'm going to feel your pulse. Your heart's beating? That has to be your heart beating.
Gordon?
I think I can feel his pulse beat.
The doctor isn't in, and they don't know where he is or when he'll be back.
That's ridiculous. They must know where he is.
Wait a minute. There's a hospital in Eastover.
How do we get in there?
Well, they'd send an ambulance, wouldn't they?
Of course. Look, Mother, you stay with him, and I'll call the hospital. And don't worry too much. I'm sure he's still alive.
Tell him to hurry.
Don't worry. I will.
Oh, I didn't mean it. Please, believe me, I didn't mean it. I'd never have said the things I did if I thought this would happen. Please, believe me. Colin Gordon's calling the Eastover Hospital for an ambulance. And they'll come and they'll get you and they'll put you to bed there. And they'll take good care of you and you'll be all right. I know you will. Oh, dear Lord, what have I done to you?
Father, the ambulance is coming right away.
Oh, good.
Can you feel his pulse beat?
Well, I haven't tried. I don't know how.
Let me try.
Nothing like this has ever happened before. I feel so helpless.
Oh, no, I'm sure I feel his pulse. Try not to worry too much, Mother. The ambulance will be here, and they'll take him to the hospital.
It's a very good hospital.
You think we should try to move him onto the couch?
I don't know, should we?
They're always telling you not to move people. I'll just let him lie where he is till help comes.
Hand me the ask, and I'll put it over him. Should we put something on his head, do you think?
My jacket.
Yeah, that pillow. Why doesn't any of us know what to do when something like this happens? Why haven't we learned?
Because we never think anything like this is going to happen. We think we'll just go on being healthy and living forever. We know it isn't true, but we think it just the same.
When it does happen, it's such a shock.
Now, look. Mother, we've made him as comfortable as we can.
Do you think we should try to give him some brandy?
Mother, his heart's beating. He's lying flat on the floor. He's covered up. He's warm. We've done everything we can. So, We'll just sit here quietly and wait for the ambulance.
All right, if you say so.
Would you, do you want me to get you a drink? Whiskey?
No! The last thing in the world I want right now is a drink. I don't need it and I don't want it.
All right. Whatever you say.
Suppose you think it's funny when I've depended on spirits to see me through everything else.
No, I don't think it's funny at all.
But now, when it's so serious... Such a shock. I want my mind clear. I don't want to blab out anything. I want to be useful. I want to help any way I can. The last thing in the world I want is to do.
All right now. We'll just sit here and hold each other's hand and wait for help to come.
Yes, that's the thing to do.
Mother, you and Father were having an argument, weren't you?
Yes, we were.
I couldn't help hearing part of it.
I was shouting at him, wasn't I?
Well, for everybody, you wouldn't call it shouting, but for you, it was pretty loud. You've always been so quiet.
Outside, I've been quiet. Inside, I've been screaming.
Always? Has it always been that way?
Ever since I can remember.
When you shouted at Father, it was about me, wasn't it?
No, if you heard me.
You told him he never had a son.
Did I really say that?
Well, I was right outside the door. I heard most of it.
I was really terribly upset.
Father said you were trying to get back at him for something.
Yes, that was it. I was. For all his bullying and the way he insisted on having his own way about everything, the way he tried to run your life and mine. He was the lord of the manor. His word was law, and if you didn't measure up to what he thought you ought to be, well, the sky fell in.
Like me, failing the exam.
Everybody had to be perfect. Well, He never claimed to be perfect.
Like me falling off Princess and just lying there.
Oh, like me forgetting to have his boots polished. Like forgetting to order soda water for a party. Like trying to mend the draperies myself and making a mess of it. Like everything. You see, Gordon, husbands can be like that. Your father isn't the only one. Oh, no, I've talked to other women, and that's the way husbands are. They work hard, they're successful, and they just take it for granted that everything that's theirs will be successful, too. They can't stand it that some of us simply were born to be failures.
You're not a failure, Mother. How can you say that?
If someone treats you like a failure, you become a failure. Gordon, I'll tell you something I've never told a living soul. I don't take a drink now and then because my back hurts. The real reason I take a drink is because I can't endure being looked down on, being treated like some kind of incompetent. I just want to block the whole thing out, forget it, make it go away and leave me alone. Just go away and leave me alone and let me sleep. Oblivion is what I want. Plain, simple oblivion. Every so often I have to have it, and I get it.
Oh, Mother, I'm so sorry. Why didn't you tell me?
It isn't the kind of thing a woman likes to talk about. As a matter of fact, I don't want to talk about it anymore, even to you. Now, tell me about you. Darling, why do you think you failed that examination?
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
Not that it matters to me.
I just couldn't go on with it. All the work I'd done, all those big grades I'd got, everything I learned, it all just sort of evaporated. It vanished, left me, as though somebody was standing in back of me. A little to my left, in back of me. I stared at the test paper. None of the questions were hard, but this thing standing in back of me, not saying anything, not making a sound, just standing there, I couldn't go on. As though my mind had left me. I didn't know anything anymore.
Oh, darling.
There didn't seem to be any point in going on, so I got up and left. There was no point in staying, so I left.
You must have been terribly frightened.
I don't remember feeling frightened. It's just peculiar.
When you came home, you did seem peculiar.
I was peculiar. Then the doctor started. Strain, overwork, anxiety, all those diagnoses. But all I felt was peculiar. So when they told me to take a sea trip, I went.
Oh, that was a mistake. I knew it at the time.
I knew it, too. But I knew it for a certainty when I was sitting in that little cafe. I just mailed that postal card to you, and I sat down to have some coffee. And sitting there, I felt this presence again, this thing, or this somebody, standing behind me a little to the left. Never touched me, or spoke to me, or even made a gesture. Just stood behind my left shoulder. And after a few days, I took the boat back home.
I'm so glad you did.
Somebody's at the door.
Oh, it's the ambulance, thank the Lord.
Yeah, I'll let them in. I must say they were quick getting here.
Show them right in here, Gordon.
Oh, I'm glad you're here. He's right inside.
Well, I'm just here to deliver a message.
You're not from the hospital?
No, I'm from the Strait of Manitoba.
Gordon?
That's my mother.
What's taking them so long?
It's a very short message, but I gave my solemn word I'd deliver it.
Gordon, what is it? What's holding them up?
It's not the ambulance, Mother. It's this man. He says he has a message he promised to deliver.
Well, what's the message?
Right, I've got it written down here. It says, "Remember me kindly, Nelly," and it's signed Harry Gordon Maynard.
That's all?
No, there's a bit more. It says, "Take care of our son." And that's all. Well, I won't be keeping you. You got the message and...
Wait a minute. Where is this Harry Gordon, Maynard? Where is he now?
Well, Harry died at sea. He's buried there. Proper burial at sea.
When did he die, do you know?
It were June. June the 15th it was. Died in the arms, poor fella. You got the message all wet down there, so I'll be getting along.
Thank you.
Harry Gordon Maynard. HGM.
The initials you signed on the postal card.
My real father. He's been with me all this time. He's been the present. Mother waited by the door for the ambulance. I went back into the living room to sit on the floor beside the man I'd called father all my life. What would we tell him when the doctors had revived him? What would be kind? What would be honest? What would be best for him? For us? Only one thing was certain. Nothing would ever be the same for anyone.
Some would prefer to call the present a ghost, a specter, a spirit. I myself do not much care for any of these words, but I do believe that each one of us carries in his or her head not simply one, but many presences of people we know or have known, love or have loved, and they will not leave us alone. I'll be back shortly. Do you sometimes hear the voice of your mother calling you for dinner? Do you ever see your father's face shining with pleasure or frowning in disappointment? Do you feel the touch of your grandmother or grandfather? Whether any or all of them are alive or dead, you are remembering and you are sensing their presence. Our cast included Norman Rose, Elspeth Eric, and Russell Horton. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Ravenhouse Paperback Mysteries.
This is E.G. Marshall, inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.